pushing down the quality control. Somebody threw a span and they threw him in the hole. There's rumors in the Logan Bay and anger in the town. Somebody blew the whistle and the walls came down. There's a meeting in the boardroom, they're trying to trace the smell. There's a leaking in the washroom, there's a sneaking personnel. Somewhere in the corridor, someone was heard to sneeze. Goodness me, could this be industrial disease? Caretaker was crucified and sleeping at his post. Refusing to be pacified, it's him they blame the most. Watchdog or rabies, a foreman got a fillet. Everyone concerned about industrial disease. There's panic on the switchboard, tongues and knots. Some come out in sympathy, some come out in spots. Some blame the management, some the employees. Everybody knows it's an industrial disease.
Welcome to Dead Air Live. My name is Laura Barrett, and I'll be hosting tonight's program on tackling the toxics threat. Tonight's program is being aired live on March 13th in Somerville in Cambridge over the newly established institutional network. In the studio with me tonight are three experts on the damage that toxic chemicals can cause to both the workers in the workplace, to consumers, and to the environment in general. All three of our guests favor reducing our society's reliance on these toxic chemicals as the best solution to the problem. The first guest I'll be talking to tonight is Bill Ryan. Bill is the director of PIRG Toxics Action. Thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you, Laura. Thank you for allowing us to be here.
For the past 6 years, Bill's been working for state and national public interest research groups, drafting laws to help society cope with the toxic threat. He's the author of the two most far-reaching toxic use reduction laws in the country, which were promoted by PIRGs and enacted in Massachusetts and Oregon in 1989. Sitting next to Bill is Kathleen Porter. It's nice to have you on, Kathy.
Thank you.
Kathy's been the Source Reduction Program Manager for the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Management for the past 2 years. Prior to that, she spent 2 years working on use reduction as an environmental engineer for Texas Instruments. In the course of her work, she's visited many, many manufacturing plants and offered technical assistance to companies that want to reduce their reliance on toxic chemicals. To her right is Dr. Nicholas Ashford, an associate professor of technology and policy at MIT. Professor Ashford is the former chairman of the Federal Occupational Safety and Health Administration's Advisory Committee, and presently he serves on the EPA's National Advisory Committee on Technology Transfer. The author of many books and appeared on many national television programs to discuss this sort of issue. Thank you for joining us tonight.
It's a pleasure.
The first question I want to ask I'll address to Bill, and I want you to describe to us where people come into contact with these chemicals that can be hazardous.
Well, the chemicals that we're talking about, in general, hazardous chemicals, are literally everywhere in our society. Probably the place where most people get the most exposure, or where the most people in our society are most severely exposed, would be in the workplace. Our society's consciousness has risen a great deal in recent years around these toxic chemicals in the environment, whether it be in our water, in our drinking water, in the air, or other places. And then in the place where a lot of information is now coming out that we really didn't realize was in the home. Actually through exposure through consumer products. So that recently certain studies have shown that the exposure to these chemicals may be 2 to 3 times in the home because of the consumer products that we buy and the ubiquitous nature of these chemicals. So this is where we're finding a lot more of these chemicals these days.
What exactly, Professor Ashford, are the problems that people can experience medically from exposure to these chemicals?
Well, of course, the first one that comes to mind, which everyone probably talks about, is cancer. We know that chemicals certainly are capable of causing a variety of cancers. But beyond cancer, there are many other problems which are ordinary diseases of life which can be caused or exacerbated by exposure to chemicals. They include heart disease, kidney and liver disease, lung disease, neurological problems, all kinds of systemic poisonings, and just plain not feeling good, being very depressed, being very foggy in terms of being able to understand or learn. This problem occurs in schools. And I just want to underscore what Bill Ryan was saying. The two places that are really significant for human exposure are either industrial workplaces or the home or residential buildings or office buildings, because indoor air pollution, as he said, has its origin not only in the chemicals that are used there, but off-gassing chemicals from the materials that are used to make the building, the fact that we no longer have fully ventilated buildings in a correct way, and the carpets and a variety of things that we buy. So indoor air pollution and occupational exposure are the highest levels of exposures. And so that's what we're beginning to see.
The kinds of risks you're describing, the kinds of illnesses that people can get, obviously sound horrendous. But Kathy, I have a question for you in terms of whether these risks are truly unacceptable, insofar as we do have still a fairly high rate of longevity in this country. A refrain you commonly hear is that people are going to die anyway, and is this not just a price we pay that there's an incremental chance you'll get cancer from chemicals that you use? Isn't this just a price we pay for living in the modern world?
I think the tragedy is that a lot of these exposures are avoidable. A lot of our current toxic chemical use is more a question of habit than it is a question of necessity. In many industries, we've demonstrated that we don't need to use the chemicals that we're using to do the jobs we want to do. Not even calling into question the usefulness of various products, we can just look at the ways we make them and see if there are less hazardous materials that we can use in the ways that we make them.
I think one of the responses to that is we really don't know. We've been really using these chemicals for a fairly short period of time, a lot of them, and there really isn't the scientific basis to know exactly what the nature of the threats are. We've identified certain chemicals that we know cause cancer or don't cause cancer, but most of the work that's been done is primarily around cancer and the other types of problems that Nick is talking about. There's a just tremendous paucity of information on what is the problem here.
Well, there's a major problem, and that is many of these diseases are chronic. And so the time between the exposure and the discovery of diseases can be many decades. And so people really don't know what the causes were. In fact, the very fact that we find that certain chemicals cause problems, like asbestos causing unique kinds of problems of pleural cancer, vinyl chloride causing a very unique form of liver cancer, These are fortuitous discoveries. Because if they cause ordinary lung cancer, they cause ordinary liver cancer, a variety of other things, then you don't make the connection between the exposure and the disease, which follows many years later. So I think it's a guesswork, but it's an educated guesswork that the problems that we're seeing are important. There's several important facts one could look at. First of all, cancer has increased steadily since the turn of the century, and we can only explain 50% of the cancer rise in terms of not dying from other things and other kinds of problems which are directly attributable to those cancer deaths. So 50% of the rise remains unexplained. And we shouldn't have to be paying these kinds of prices to live a modern 20th century lifestyle. I mean, many of the chemicals have substitutes. They can be used in safer ways. Our lifestyles can change without really lowering our standard of living. And these are things that we have to do in a conscious way. We need both industry and consumers to come together to fashion solutions.
Yeah, I don't think it's that important to know exactly what the risks are. We have the situation of whether it's Woburn in Massachusetts or whether it's Stringfellow acid pits in California or the problems of benzene and other volatile chemicals that are found in, say, the LA smog basin. The bottom line is we really don't know. And the question I think that we're real interested in exploring and what we've talked about a lot is there a way to not use these chemicals in the first place, which is one of the things that we're here to talk about.
Yeah, that's a very important way to frame the question. If you let the debate be driven by science, then the question becomes, how dangerous are these chemicals? What is the risk assessment that you can perform? What is the dose and the response that emerges? And you can get lost forever. And many of my friends, my fellow academics, get lost forever doing risk assessments. There's a lot of people now engaged as toxicologists, epidemiologists, and scientists looking at these questions. But we're not stopping long enough to ask, do we want to do a $300,000 feeding study in animals to determine whether something is carcinogenic? Or could we use that $300,000 to develop a substitute that we assure are safer? So we have to shift the debate from risk-focused and science-focused to technology-focused to ask, what could we do to change it in the face of uncertainty? Because uncertainty will continue to be there.
Well, to play devil's advocate, though, isn't it useful to do risk assessment as to at least where the greatest problems are? For example, I think in our society right now, people are concerned about hazardous waste dump sites. But from what you were saying earlier, it sounds as if workplace and in-home exposure may be greater. And isn't that kind of assessment, is that true? And is that kind of assessment valuable to make?
Well, it's true, but you have to distinguish between assessing risks and prioritizing them and assessing opportunities for risk reduction, because the largest risks are not necessarily the ones that will immediately be responsive to changes. For example, lead smelters. You can close them down, but there are very few ways to eliminate the lead coming out of lead smelters, so it's a major source of problem. On the other hand, lead in gasoline, very easy solution in terms of changing the internal combustion engine and so forth. So what you really have to do is you have to ask, where is the opportunity to change the technology the greatest, which will lead to the greatest reduction in risk? I think we've been misled by simply prioritizing the risks and saying, let's go after the big bang first.
Well, what about the solution that seems to be what our society has focused on heretofore, which is cleaning up hazardous chemicals after the fact? In other words, there's a lot of concentration on hazardous waste site cleanup and less on what you've been talking about in terms of source reduction. Maybe, Bill, you can address that. Is that still a valuable thing to be doing, to go to these sites and try to clean them up?
Well, back in 1970 or so, when we had the spate of environmental laws that were passed, the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, and the Occupational Safety and Health Act, there was a tremendous emphasis on what can we do to control these pollutants once they're coming off a process? What can we do to control or mitigate the problems once they've already been created? And we spent 20 years and many billions of dollars in our society trying to do that. And with a relative amount of success. If you just look at what we're seeing in Eastern Europe today versus the types of pollution problems that we see in this country, I think we see the impact that the pollution control system that we put in place has actually had. We've avoided a lot of the problems that we're now coming to understand actually exist there. But we haven't improved that much. The goal that was set out in 1970 of making all of our waters fishable and swimmable, clearly we're not even close to that. So we need to be reevaluating that whole system. And there's been emerging a whole way of thinking which begins to question, well, why do we use these chemicals in the first place? Can we change the ways that we produce things? Can we change the products so that we don't have so many of these chemicals, so we don't create so much waste in the first place to have to then try and control? We still need to continue to do pollution control. We've got thousands of dump sites out there. We've got many smokestacks that we still have to deal with. We've got the whole problem of automobiles that we still have to deal with. So we can't stop doing that, but we need to add a whole nother way of thinking and actually shift. It's really going to come down to changing the way that people think and go back and really question the basic technologies that we use to accomplish all the things that we want to accomplish in our everyday life, and begin to shift those around. So it's the whole concept of pollution prevention and preventing pollution in the first place.
Before we actually get on to discussing the solution, though, I want to have a few more questions I have about the problem that exists there now. When you were saying the laws have been enacted in 1970 or thereabouts, have been effective for either of you two, do you think that we're better off now, I'll put it in Ronald Reagan's terms, environmentally in this country today than we were, say, 20 years ago?
Well, I think Bill has answered some of the question. We've made very good inroads in reducing some air pollutants, some water pollutants, but the curious part of the history is the cleanup efforts in air and water have resulted in creating a solid waste, which we ended up putting in so-called sanitary landfills, which weren't too sanitary and were pretty porous. And with the fact that the toxics migrated back into the underground water supplies and ruined our water. So we did an incomplete job by simply starting with air and water. I think now we have to distinguish between cleaning up those mistakes and generating future pollution, because they're two very, very different problems. And the truth of the matter is the bulk of exposure to human beings comes not from hazardous waste dumps and not from existing waste, but from the chemical production process, the production, the use, and the consumption of chemicals or chemical-based products. There's where the vast majority of problems really continue to emerge. And also, those are the problems that are future-looking. We can change the production. All we can do on solid waste sites or hazardous waste sites is to cap them, clean them up, move people out of places like Times Beach, Missouri, and so forth. Kathy, maybe you.
Yeah, actually, I think one of the associated problems that our current environmental regulations have caused is that they do encourage this pollutant shifting from as we control emissions to one medium, we tend to create a waste for another. Often that's resulted ultimately in solid waste that we don't have very many good solutions for managing. It's also resulted in something of an unfair burden on some manufacturers who find that they start out catching an air emission with, say, a water stream to wash an acid out of the air, and end up then taking that water stream and treating it to make a sludge, and then having to pay to get rid of the sludge, and basically chasing the same contaminant around. One of the exciting things about pollution prevention is that businesses have an opportunity to eliminate many of those expenditures on pollution control and just address the problem in the first place at the source.
When you mentioned that the problems that some industries have in chasing the pollutants around, it makes me think of a question about whether who's to blame for all this? Are industries as a whole, are all industries the same? Is it our society? I mean, where's the fault lie?
Well, industries, I think it's an important thing to understand that industries are not the same. That is, even within the same kind of industry like electroplating, those are those industries with advanced technologies which recover a lot of material, and those that simply put it down the drain. And from industry to industry, or productive segment to productive segment, things really differ. And what's very, very important to understand is that industry is an important partner in the shift towards a technology-based approach. We need to move aside the old methods and technologies and put in the new methods, the new substitutes, the new processes. Now, if the existing regulated companies can do that, then that's terrific. But we may have to face some hard choices where existing industries will have to be retired. New products, new industries, new methods. That's what innovation is all about. That's how we move our industrial system ahead. We don't want it frozen, either for environmental reasons or employment reasons or economic reasons in the short term.
It's often true when a business looks at the full cost associated with running a process and accounts for all the environmental costs that a specific process is responsible for, it'll turn out that some of the older processes that are very waste generating are no longer economically viable. And it's only because a company averages costs out over the whole business that they won't notice that some of these more recalcitrant or these older manufacturing processes will end up causing a lot more cost than they end up generating profit.
It sounds like you're suggesting that there have to be vast changes in the way that industry managers think about these problems. And in fact, I guess these problems are relatively new. Maybe, Bill, you could give us the history of how we got to where we are. I mean, how long have these industries been in existence where these toxic chemicals have been widely used?
Well, the types of toxic chemicals that we're talking about really can be put in two different categories. One are the naturally occurring chemicals that have been with us for as long as we've had people. People are well familiar with the lead poisoning that the Romans experienced, or, for example, mercury has been used for many, many years. The concept or the term the Mad Hatter came from the fact that people who used to paint hats using mercury-based paints, touching the brushes to their tongues, then had the mercury go in and affect their nervous systems and drove them mad. So some of those chemicals have been with us for many years and we've experienced a number of problems. There's another class of chemicals that have basically been synthesized in the laboratory, synthetic organic chemicals. And to just give you a statistic that I think captures how recently those chemicals have come into place. In 1940, in this country, we produced about a million tons of synthetic organic chemicals. In 1987, we produced over 125 million tons. So in that very short time from the time of World War II till now, we've increased the production of those chemicals by about 12,000%. So a tremendously rapid rise, and it's really that concentration of chemical use of those types of chemicals that has led to just the widespread concern about these chemicals that we now experience. So it's a relatively recent development in our society in many ways.
Is the problem here related to the famous line in The Graduate, plastics?
I think plastics is one face of the chemical industry, as Nick described. The chemical industry basically in this country didn't exist, the petrochemical industry we should really say, because it's all one part of the larger problem, didn't really even exist until the turn of the century. And as a result of advertising, as a result of many developments that occurred, plastics became one product that were pushed very hard in the 60s, as The Graduate movie was all about. And But plastic is just one part of all of the products that we get from petroleum and therefore chemicals. But plastics is a piece of it.
Barry Commoner says we should be particularly concerned about the chlorinated hydrocarbons, that they have systematically replaced natural products like wood and glass and a variety of other things, which are much more environmentally sound. And our evolutionary soup did not contain these chlorinated hydrocarbons, so our bodies, you know, did not evolve with repair mechanisms and other things which ordinarily would take care of an evolutionary problem. And so I think it's very important. By the way, I think it's important to understand that one thing that we're hearing these days is it's not the chemicals outside, it's the chemicals in our foods, it's the natural carcinogens. This is really overplaying what is an important but not a dominating problem. There may be carcinogens in our natural food supply, but our body, the epithelial cells in the internal part of the body, kind of shaves off, those cells shave off, and one doesn't have the same kind of cancer events as you do in the lung when you breathe things. So ingesting things and inhaling things are very, very different. So it's a little bit disingenuous to talk about the milligrams of carcinogens ingested versus the milligrams inhaled, because the route of exposure is very different. So people should not believe that the majority of the problems come through the diet. Some important problems do, but not the majority.
Let me shift gears a little bit to talk about how we deal with the toxic threat then. I know you've all been alluding to it throughout the first part of this program, but I want to concentrate here on what this pollution prevention idea is that you've been talking about, and maybe, Bill, you could summarize it.
Yeah, broadly, what we're talking about is changing the way that we actually accomplish things, taking the technologies that we produce things with, the manufacturing processes that we use, the automobiles that we use, the products we use, and actually changing those to not use toxic chemicals or create pollution in the first place. So it's a fairly fundamentally simple idea. It's also not a fundamentally accepted idea across the country, and we're at a point now at which education and outreach on this idea is going to be extremely important. We really need to change the way that people think about dealing with pollution. But that's what we're talking about. Taking, for example, and rather than using, let's say, oil-based paints is a good example, which are made from solvents, which are often toxic, and using water-based paints instead is a simple example. And there's a plethora of other examples. Kathy has worked with a number of firms that have been doing this kind of thing.
Sure. Another example that you remind me of is Nick was just talking about chlorinated hydrocarbons. Often we find people use chlorinated hydrocarbons in cleaning and degreasing operations. A range of chlorinated solvents, including trichloroethane and a bunch of other the common dry cleaning solvents, would be included, or ones that are used for metal cleaning. There are now some viable management alternatives for dry cleaners so that their usage has dropped dramatically, but there are also substitutes. Specifically in the metal cleaning operations, we've found people have had very good success. As a matter of fact, we've documented a range of case studies. People who switch over from using a chlorinated solvent to using a water-based material and demonstrate not only that they get parts as clean, but sometimes cleaner. And they've also found that workplace complaints have decreased dramatically. People often complain about headaches or other nervous system effects associated with chlorinated solvents. And these safer substitutes often generate a lot of support from people in the workplace. They get really excited about being able to use something safer.
When you talk about metal cleaning, do you mean like for the high-tech industry?
It could be the high-tech industry. Could also be other common industries like automobile production, like jewelry production, I think of. Almost anything using metal involves a cleaning step. It's just it's part of metal product manufacture.
You're quite a garage.
Absolutely. Yeah. The auto body shops and the garages, the car dealerships.
Well, when people talk about toxic use reduction, you've given one example of substituting one kind of a dangerous chemical that's a cleaning agent for a safer one. What are some other examples of ways that in the manufacturing process you can actually reduce your reliance on chemicals? Are there, for example, physical processes you can use instead of chemical ones? Or
one good example that actually came out of the Defense Department is that people talk about a lot is is they used to use the same kind of solvents to strip the paint off planes that had to be constantly repainted to keep the right specifications. And one company developed a basically almost a sandblasting type of equipment where they use plastic beads that knock the paint off, and then the paint falls down, you collect it, you can recycle the plastic beads, so you completely eliminate the use of that particular solvent. That's a good example.
It isn't just the product substitution is very important, but so is process change. And I think the wonderful historical example that comes to mind is polyvinyl chloride plastics. Originally, vinyl chloride is a carcinogen. It caused cancer, liver cancer in workers. Very, very strong carcinogen. And the process to make a resin, which is a polyvinyl chloride resin from which plastics are made, was a process which didn't use all the vinyl chloride carcinogen. And Goodrich had accelerated a process as a result of regulation which used up all the vinyl chloride so that the resin didn't contain any free vinyl chloride. Now there's a case where you're making the same plastic, but you're making it using all the material. So you're reclaiming material, you're saving energy, and you're solving an occupational health and safety problem, as well as reducing the emissions to the outside environment. So with one technological change, one can solve air, water, waste, and occupational exposures. That's the remarkable promise of a technology-driven approach. That you, instead of saying, well, you know, do something different for water, do something different for air, you've caused people to look at the area together and ask the question, what can we do to change the process?
One example that's also come out of the high-tech industry is cutting CFC use, not by changing the cleaning agent itself, but by changing a previous step, by saying, well, the reason we need this agent is to clean off a flux that's applied in a previous step. And if we switch to a flux that's cleaner application that doesn't need to be cleaned off, it's got relatively low solids and it evaporates really well, then you don't have to clean it off with the chlorofluorocarbons afterward, which are thought to contribute to ozone depletion.
Well, these technologies, if industries have to do them in a wide scale, raise the price of products for consumers?
In some cases, yes. In some cases, no. I mean, in terms of the actual price that the consumer sees. But if you want to talk about the hidden prices of indoor air pollution, occupational exposure, having to pay high Social Security taxes or other things in order to give people the kind of basic living levels that they need, I'm not at all convinced that we already aren't paying far, far too much. We pay an enormous amount of money to clean up the problems. I mean, the Superfund cleanup, millions and billions of dollars are going to be spent to clean up a mistake. And so it's not clear at all that everyone isn't going to be a winner by the time we begin to look at technology in a different way.
One of the things that you're trying to do here is to stimulate people to change the way they do things. This is not going to happen overnight. But the experience to date has been that the costs of getting rid of all of these hazardous waste, for example, that because people have effectively made it difficult and very hard for these companies to get rid of these wastes, it's become fairly expensive for them to get rid of them. And those costs, the cost of liability for Superfund sites, the cost of occupational health and safety programs, have actually made it more cost effective to invest in these kinds of things, at least for the short run. So that by doing pollution prevention, you're actually avoiding costs. And in most cases, you'll actually be able to save the company money and save the consumer money, at least for a while, until those costs even out. In fact, the Congress's Office of Technology Assessment did a study a few years ago that predicted that you could literally cut or reduce the amount of waste that we produce by 50% in this country, the amount of waste going into air, water, and land, which in recent surveys indicates over 22 billion pounds of these chemicals per year going off-site in some way, could actually be reduced in half, say within 5 years, if we put our minds to it, and save companies money. So. So for the short run, at least, pollution prevention means good economic sense for companies as well.
I think it's important to know that it's not simply the environmentalists that are making this claim. For example, the German Bundesbank has a full-page ad in The Economist a few issues ago which said good environment is good business. And it continually talks about the fact that investment strategies should reflect environmentally sound technologies. And so what's exciting also in this country is that there are a group of industrialists now that who really are firmly committed the changing technology. Let me say that they're basically not the pollution control industry. The pollution control industry had a very useful role to play. It sold devices like gas deck scrubbers and lead traps and a variety of treatment technologies. We're reaching a plateau in terms of being able to solve those problems. And so it's not the pollution control industry now that is at the cutting edge of promoting technological change. It is the promoters of new process technology, asbestos substitutes, and industry's becoming very sanguine about the fact that there's a market opportunity here. And if they are becoming convinced there's a market opportunity, then the cries that this is too expensive or you have to trade off your health against the environment issues, against the jobs, I think are going to fall on deaf ears, because I think these aren't the problems anymore.
Well, some of the companies that we've worked with have actually shifted from laying people off to hiring people based on incorporating pollution prevention strategies in the ways that they do business. One company in particular we worked with was having trouble with metals in their wastewater. They knew they were going to have to put on some kind of new system to get the metal back out of the wastewater. They costed it out, and using conventional technologies, it looked like it was going to be about $500,000 for a plant that employs about 250 people. And they make employee recognition products. So they looked at it, and they looked at how they were doing the job, and they discovered that by using some recycling strategies, by being really careful in how they did the processes and keeping metal back in the process, they didn't have to clean it up at the end of the pipe. The water supply that they have now is totally recirculated. They cemented over their drain. Their water is 40 times cleaner than the city water supply. Their product quality has gone up because their rinse water is cleaner. Their workers are excited about it. They've saved all this money. They paid back that whole system in less than 2 years. And as it turned out, the city that they're in had to cut off water supply because they had an interruption in the city water main with doing construction activity. All the other competitors in the area had to shut down for 2 days, and they got to stay in business. They said if they could count that in the payback, it would have been a lot shorter. It's been really exciting.
Yeah, we don't want to paint this all as motherhood and apple pie. As I said, at least for a while, I think we'll find these kinds of gains. Because in part, you're just stimulating companies to think about what they're doing. And when they begin to do that, they actually think harder and they come up with good ideas. We're finding a lot of resistance actually to these ideas as well from companies who are finding it difficult to change. People are pretty set in their ways oftentimes, and so it's difficult. You've got to push them oftentimes to change. When they do, you find some success stories like this. In other industries, as we were talking about before, you're not going to find quite the same number of success stories. In the not too distant future, at some point in the future, some of these cost things will even out, and in order to get more pollution prevention happening, we may need to push companies that much harder, but we're just in a good phase right now.
Well, if indeed the companies can, or at least some companies can, save money on their bottom line by doing pollution prevention, won't that be what drives them to do it, the marketplace? In other words, that they'll make profits. And if that's so, why aren't more of them doing it?
There are major attitudinal problems. I mean, there's still people who don't want to change or touch their technology. It works now, it ain't broke, don't fix it. And any kind of technological change engenders some sort of risk. I mean, the things will not be quite the same. So there's an aversion to changing things. There's an attitudinal problem still, I'm sorry to say, on the part of many managers, that environmental problems aren't important, or they don't have to deal with them, or they'll deal with them later. You know, the pressures of production, the pressures of competition, a variety of other things. So there has to be a wholesale shift in attitude, as well as a knowledge shift in terms of the technologies that are available or possible. Both those things have to occur.
It's not that much different than the problems that we have, or that are cited in any number of studies of American industry today, just across the board. The failure to be responding to market conditions, to move forward, to come up with new ideas and stuff. And so, actually, we feel that toxic use reduction types of concepts requiring people to really focus on this can actually help stimulate industry in many ways. So it's kind of a funny cross these
days.
Kind of
using the marketplace as well as mandates.
Right.
Do you see any other countries that perhaps do a better job than we do that we can learn from, or are we at the cutting edge?
I actually think that it depends how you look at the problem. All Western European countries, industrialized countries, pretty well clean up air, water pollution. I think we're at the cutting edge on the issue of focusing on the problem of toxics use reduction. I think we're the ones who are going to develop, and this is exciting because there's a world market there. We may develop processes and products which the Japanese, the Germans, the French, the English have not thought of yet. And so it may be that we're really going to be at the cutting edge on those particular kinds of issues. As far as pollution control devices is concerned, there's some indication the Germans and the Swedes are actually ahead of us. As I indicated earlier, we may have exhausted the better opportunities in pollution control anyway, and we need to move on to toxic use reduction.
Internationally, the word of choice is called clean technologies. And so when you hear our colleagues in other countries talk about that's generally the term that they use. We've, in the studies that we've done, it doesn't look, as Nick has suggested, like they're pursuing this avenue that aggressively. It's beginning to catch on that much more, but I think the work that's being done in Massachusetts, in New Jersey, and other parts of the country is really very much cutting edge types of work.
Well, let's talk about that, because I want to talk about what are the ways that we as a society can make this toxic use reduction happen. And I know one of the ways that I said in the introduction was that the PURGs got two toxic use reduction laws passed in Massachusetts and Oregon in 1989. So we have some concrete examples, at least of one route, which is the legislative route. So Bill, maybe you can describe what those laws do and how they're working.
You know, those laws, we probably spent 5 or 6 years developing the ideas for these laws. And in fact, a lot of the ideas, I think, came from work that Nick had done showing that regulations can actually get companies to change the way they do things. And taking that as a basic premise, we began to try and develop some kind of proposal that could the legislatures could pass in various states that would promote these kinds of things. And we slogged around for four or five years before we finally settled in on the proposals that eventually became the new toxic use reduction laws in Massachusetts and Oregon. We work with a number of researchers, both inside the public interest research groups, with other groups such as National Toxic Campaign, Greenpeace, with researchers from places like MIT, Nick's associates, to develop these ideas. And then the hard part started, where we actually began to take on the campaigns, the political campaigns that were necessary to get those laws in place.
First of all, why don't you describe how those laws work?
Well, they really work from the basic premise right now that that it is in the company's best interest to do this. So if you can just get them to think about what the opportunities are, you've actually won half the battle. So basically what these laws require is that are the companies report on their use of toxic chemicals. Surprisingly enough, until you begin to talk to people, you think they'd have perfect knowledge of how much they use, where it was going, things like that. The truth is they haven't, and recent community right to know laws have actually pushed companies to begin to think about this. So the idea was to get them to report on what they were using and to actually complete plans for how they might go about reducing use, consulting with experts, coming up with ideas, and actually going through the economic analysis that was necessary to show that they'd actually be able to make themselves money. We coupled that then with an equal emphasis on requiring the government change the way it thinks, and so that the agencies, rather than having a water pollution person and an air pollution person and an occupational safety and health person, we've established requirements that those people begin to work together so that they are looking at the problem more from the perspective of this toxic chemical that's being used and is affecting all those various places, as opposed to looking at it individually and trying to do something about it. The third thing that we did is we really tried to involve the public by giving them access to information, because information is a very powerful tool. And by making that information that the companies were reporting available to citizens, giving citizens the right to bring suits, for example, to enforce the laws and make sure that companies are doing this, we've basically empowered citizens to be able to kind of keep government and industry honest. So with a fairly minimal amount of cost to say the state, we avoided setting up some huge new bureaucracy. I think we've actually put a system in place that'll get people to fundamentally change the way they think about things, which is what our original goal was.
Kathy, I know you're working on actually following through on seeing that these laws in Massachusetts in any case are implemented. How is it working so far?
Well, it's been very exciting, to use the word again, so far. We've found the Department of Environmental Protection, which is responsible for regulatory development in this state, has begun writing the regulations that will enforce this law. They've drafted a survey which will go out to all the businesses in this state and will find out from them exactly what listed chemicals they're using, whether they're over the thresholds or not, will stimulate a lot of people thinking that may not have thought about this before, and really find out how many people will be pulled in to the requirements of the law. At the University of Lowell, we've established a Toxics Use Reduction Institute. They're pulling together academic support now to provide a research base for alternatives to technologies and chemicals that are being used now. The group that I'm a part of will be providing technical assistance to businesses to transfer some of the technology that's developed in academia, and also to assist in demonstration projects in businesses, and to just provide a sounding board for businesses to talk about what's working for them, and to enable other businesses to find out what they can do.
From what you've been hearing from businesses so far, are they resisting this as another mandate, another regulation, more paperwork, or are they saying, yes, the time has come, this is something that we have to do?
It was remarkable about the development of this particular law that industry was actively involved, perhaps from an early stage. They were definitely on the negotiating committees for the last year, and they've come out with a product that they've decided they can live with and that they think is optimal. I think they're definitely interested in seeing the regulatory agency integrate its approach to cut down on permitting paperwork, to cut down to some extent on inspection times, but just to make it simpler to deal with the regulatory agency. They're also, I think, interested in getting a greater degree of technical support. The technical assistance groups will be better funded and larger than they have been in the past. This research center will bring a lot of credibility to this anecdotal evidence we have so far that pollution prevention is possible. So there seems to be a lot of support from the business community. I think also they want to find out what this is going to look like in implementation, and they'll be really interested to see in the coming years how it unfolds. But I think they're interested in the opportunity to rethink their processes and to get a really good look at how they're using chemicals now.
Bill, how did you get industry to come to the table instead of fighting this the way they often do with mandates?
Well, we basically dragged them kicking and screaming to the table. As I said, we started after we came up with the basic ideas and kind of checked with a number of people to make sure they made sense. We started the hard part. And, in both Massachusetts and Oregon, it took the public interest research groups there 3 years from the time we started educating primarily the public about these things, started getting the word out, started making this into a major issue, until we finally brought these companies to the table. The way we started out was just went out and built support among the public, who are keenly aware in many of these states of the problems associated with toxic chemicals. And by getting them educated as to this kind of new way of thinking, which is so commonsensical that, that it doesn't take long to try and convince somebody. And then by getting them actively involved and actually communicating with their legislators, beginning to write letters to their local newspaper saying this is the way the state needs to go, we built a real sense of the future, I think, kind of in the communities around the state. And a lot of those people that we're talking to, who are members of the public that we go and we talk to day to day, every day, work in these facilities. And so we really started the education process then, and it was amazing the very positive response we got from people saying, yeah, we think this, you know, I could do this kind of thing in my workplace. So we spent a couple of years doing that, focusing then people's political activity and getting involved in working with their legislators. We, in Massachusetts, for example, we got over 130 of 200 legislators to co-sponsor the particular piece of legislation that we were working with, which was the largest number that I was aware of at the time of majority of legislators sponsoring such legislation. And that began to catch industry's eyes. Industry lobbyists, unlike their technical people or the people who are working in facilities, a lot of times are just interested in stopping anything that's going to impact them in any way, and that was the attitude we saw for a long time. So we built, through citizen involvement, a real base of political support. And then we kind of followed through by threatening the ultimate in citizen activism around this, which is to take that piece of legislation rather than trying to get through the legislature, take it directly to the people, and said that we would, if we didn't get a response from industry, take it to the ballot in both of these states. In which case, the industry people grudgingly came to the table in both states, then in working with legislators working with members of industry and some of the more progressive people in industry hammered out after, you know, meeting twice a week and negotiating and educating each other, which is as much an important part of these processes as actually passing the law, were able to come to some resolution that that industry felt like they could live with and avoided the necessity to go to the ballot. So those are success stories, and I think the industry, it took a lot of education, took a lot of knowledge on our part of understanding what the kinds of things that they were talking about. So kind of combining our expertise with the public support that we were developing, we were able to forge a compromise that then now industry is actually saying, yes, we like this, we're a part of it, as opposed to having it just shoved down their throat. So a couple success stories that way.
Well, there's a double benefit here. If you can get coordinated permitting and enforcement, industry doesn't have to make so many stops at the regulatory authority. And if you marry this idea to toxics use reduction, you get multimedia toxics reduction, you get new technology, and you got one-stop shopping. And I think that those three things, it's the power of those three things coming together, realizing that they're all part of the same package, that gets some people to turn their heads with acceptance in the idea.
Nick, in addition to passing legislation to bring about toxics use reduction, are there other techniques that people can use in society or that our society can use to bring this about?
You know, I think that you need a whole mix of carrots and sticks. The legislation is a very important part of getting people to realize what it is they want. Kathy's already talked about technical assistance and demonstration projects to show people in industries that certain things can be done. But in addition, you need very stringent regulations, which are also flexible. Now, that sounds contradictory, and I'll tell you what I mean. You need it to be very stringent in terms of requiring a significant reduction in risk. You need it to be flexible by allowing companies to get more time if they want to embark on an innovative technology, what is called technology waivers. You need to be able to look carefully at the tax incentives for investment. Right now, we give accelerated depreciation treatment, which is special tax treatment, to pollution control equipment. We don't give it to changing the regular technology. So what happens is, dollar per dollar, if an industrialist says, I'll change my technology or I'll buy a device, they buy a device because it's more attractive from a tax perspective. We've got to change the tax incentives. Speaking of taxes, I think it's a good idea, along with stringent regulations, to tax the inputs to the industrial process so people stand up and look and see how much benzene they're using, how much toluene they're using, to see if they're really using the cheapest possible product.
I mean, tax the chemicals themselves.
And tax production at the waste end as well. You've got to hit front end and waste end. And maybe the most powerful economic incentives, because that's what we need as well as regulation and legislative approaches, is imposing what is called financial responsibility requirements on the firms. Now, in the waste industry, we made industry come up with insurance or letters of credit to back up the damage that they might do ahead of time, so that no one could file bankruptcy and say, well, you know, here's another toxic waste dump for the Superfund site. Now, we haven't done that for chemical producers and users. And I think very, very strongly we need to look at imposing insurance requirements on people who produce chemicals so that they can say, my insurance premium will fall if I change from organic solvents to water-based solvents, or change what I'm making, or change the kind of pesticide or the kind of intermediate I'm using. So we need economic incentives up front, and we need also to close off the easy solutions to disposal. As long as you could put something in a waste dump, nobody bothered to do things differently. Now we're talking about incinerating it rather than putting it in a dump. Well, incineration may be important for certain classification of toxic materials, but it's fundamentally long-term a bad idea. Because if you allow people to incinerate, you make it easy for them not to think about front-end reduction. So when we hear an idea like an incinerator and say, yeah, we're going to improve it over disposal, you've got to think twice about whether we're sending the wrong signal to industrial change.
Yeah, one of the most important things that that has led to these kind of concepts even being acceptable is the fact that people in their communities have been NIMBYs, as they call them, not in our backyards, not in my backyard. And that active effort on the part of citizens to actually say, no, don't put an incinerator here, has led and created the opportunity for us to even be talking about these things. Because industry, what they'd like to do is just take the stuff, get rid of it, not have to think about it. And it was that kind of mindset that that has brought us the problems that we have. So active citizen involvement in campaigns in their communities around whether it's a question of should a company be able to store more chemicals on their facility, or should they be able to build an incinerator or whatever. Those kinds of folks have been heavily criticized, but I call them the kind of the courageous front people of the battle to actually get us to think back about the kind of concepts that we're talking about.
I actually remember seeing a fairly effective poster of hazardous waste dump site barrels, and it just said, not in anyone's backyard. I mean, with the idea that NIMBYism, not in my backyard, is not necessarily a bad thing if what you're trying to prevent is something that's going to harm the neighborhood. In terms of the public health.
Of course, the question is whose neighborhood? Where do the incinerators get placed? In poor neighborhoods. Where do the where are the hazardous dumps primarily been placed, and where's the dumping going on? In poor neighborhoods and with people who really need to have some reason for bringing economics in. And I think that kind of problem, which is what Barry Commoner calls environmental blackmail, has to stop. You know, your questions remind me of an unspoken question, which is, are we talking about a tempest in a teapot here? I mean, haven't we already solved the problems? Why all this commotion? Have we done better recently than we did earlier? I think it depends upon how you construct your report card. We have certainly made some inroads in reducing pollution. But if you measure how well you do against how well you could do, we actually are doing poorer today than we were 5 years ago, and poorer 5 years ago than we were 10 years ago. Because we know more now. We are capable of doing more, and we should be measured against a moving standard. We have the technology and the ingenuity in American industry. We have some of the firms ready to play ball on this issue, and we really need to loosen national and local leadership to saying this is the direction we're going to go. And the Environmental Protection Agency, at least, has begun to talk very seriously about pollution prevention. This new National Advisory Council on Environmental Technology Transfer has got many industrialists and some public interest environmental groups on the committee. And the committee is dedicated to finding a way towards toxic use reduction. It is not the same old problem repackaged. And so there's a very exciting new discussion in town, which I hope is going to be captured at the local level as well.
You know, I think one of the most exciting things that has been leading to that is the whole consumer consciousness around these types of issues, and that there's the exciting thing about pollution prevention is it can be practiced at any level by reducing your use of chemicals in your bleach or in your the things that you're using to clean your tables or whatever. You can actually have an impact all the way back through the system by reducing your demand and basically preventing then the need to produce that thing in the first place. So there's a lot that the consumers can be doing by themselves, and there's a lot that they can do by banding together politically and just sending a very clear message that this is the way things ought to be done in the future.
The opportunity that this pressure is creating is for business to find out practically that pollution prevention can be win-win, that they can prevent environmental harm and that they can benefit economically. And they're having the chance to learn firsthand in their own facilities that they can use pollution prevention to save money and become more competitive.
Well, we're almost out of time in this program. An hour's gone by very quickly. I'm wondering, since there's a lot of material that we've covered, if perhaps, Bill, you could summarize sort of the three parts that we've been trying to get across here, what the problem is, what some of the solutions are, and how we can achieve those solutions.
Well, the problem that we've been talking about is the use of primarily synthetic chemicals that have been produced in the lab, and just the explosion in the use of those over the last 40 years or so. And all the places where those chemicals show up, whether it be in our air, in our water, in the workplace, in our homes, they become ubiquitous in our society. And what we're talking about is kind of saying, time out, let's stop and let's reevaluate whether we really need to be using all of those chemicals so extensively. Can't we find other ways of going about living our lives that don't necessarily poison the environment? And that has brought up the concept of pollution prevention, preventing pollution in the first place, toxics use reduction, reducing the use of toxics. And then the question that we've discussed is, so that's a good idea, it makes sense, it's common sense, how do you go about making that happen? And there are any number of ways of doing that, I think, that we've talked about, whether it be getting involved in helping to pass legislation like the PIRGs have passed in several states now and are working on in any number of other states, and which is now springing up in literally dozens of other states as the ideas are becoming more popular, or whether it's just taking your own activities in your own home and beginning to be much more conscious about, are there chemicals in the products I'm using, and is there an alternative that I could be using that therefore will reduce the amount of pollution that's being created throughout our society. So we're entering the threshold of a whole different way of thinking about pollution as people are becoming more aware of the environment. It offers a lot of opportunities to affect some very important changes that need to happen in this world.
Well, thank you for that summary, and I want to thank Bill Ryan, Kathy Porter, and Nick Ashford for joining me in the studio, and I want to thank you all for working so hard on pollution prevention. Good night. Thank you.